Welcome to this presentation of making BIM collections for research sustainable and reusable. We are from the Royal Danish Library. I am Els Jørgen.
And I'm Per Møldrup Dalo.
We will here present what we have done in connection with preservation of the basis of the outcome of the project probing a nation's web domain. We need to preserve the web collections so we can ensure the persistency of them, so they can later be reused and results can be verified. The project probing a nation's web domain investigated changes of the Danish web by looking at the data in the Danish web archive netarkivet. The way that this project investigated this was by taking annual collections where they only took one occurrence of each of the elements. The reason for this was not to have unbalanced statistics. It's not easy to make an algorithm that selects elements only once. This makes this project a very good example of why you should preserve the resulting collections. It was only metadata for the elements and text from text elements that was included, which we will see later means something for the creation of the collections used for preservation. We investigated several options for preserving the web collections. That included separate preservation of extraction, preservation of the program selecting the elements for the collections, the result of the selection program, archive URLs for the elements, CDX for the elements, and persistent web identifiers, also called PID, for the elements. There are several challenges if we were to preserve the extractions themselves. First of all, there's the size. You do not want to preserve 24 terabytes of data just for one project. In the Danish Netarchive, we cannot afford to have duplicates of a lot of different collections. And in Denmark, we also have an issue with jurisdictions, since we can only hand out data for 5 years, then they are obliged to delete the data again, which is not exactly preservation. Therefore, separate preservation of extraction is not an option. For the option of preserving the selection program, we first need to know a little bit more about this program. The input to the program was the crawl logs from selected harvests. It then selected the elements and merged it with information from the walk files. And lastly, it selected a lot of different information from these two sources. At first, we thought we had a challenge that we only had the crawl time and we needed the archival time. But because of the merge, we did have this information. So it was based on the program results that the Netarkivet could actually extract the elements and deliver it to the researchers. Now we can look at the challenges in preserving the collections by preserving the selection program. First of all, long-term preservation of programs is a hard discipline. If we think of emulating the program later on, we also have to think about that there can be changed APIs to the archive. For simple algorithms, it could be a question of documenting the algorithm, but it has to be very precise. And in this case, it is not a simple algorithm. Another challenge is that web archives sometimes enrich their data, for instance, by including web materials from other archives or from researchers. That would mean that if we ran the program again, we may get a different outcome. These challenges mean that we cannot be sure to get the right outcome, and therefore this approach is not feasible. If we look at the results from the extraction program, these consist of lines for each of the web elements. One of the challenges here is there's a lot more information than we need, which will take up space. To make it understandable and usable in the future, it will also require documentation of what the different parts of the lines means. We actually experience how hard it can be, even just half a year after the results from the program was made. For instance, what's the difference between the different timestamps and dates? And what does TMH and type mean? And it's not a standard format. We do therefore not want to preserve it this way. If we look at archive URL lists, there are many archives that has URLs on the form where it has a part with the web archive domain and some functional path, a part with the type of archiving, and a part with the archive URL. The challenge here is that the first part has a tendency to change, which we've already seen for several web archives. It's even worse for the Danish web archive, where it's an archive file name and then the offset. This is unfortunately not very persistent, which we experienced a few years back when we migrated to compressed files. The file name may be almost the same, but the offset certainly isn't. So we really want to find something better than this. For CDX list, it's the same as for the program output. There are too much information. There's actually also too little information because you cannot see which archive it is for. And again, it's not a stable standard. So a better alternative would be preferable. Now let's look at the persistent web identifier list, also called PID list. A PID consists of four parts: the web archive, the type of archiving in readable standardized form, and the archive URL. This is exactly the information needed to uniquely identify any element in any archive. Furthermore, the PID has a precision part. The precision specifies what the PID covers. It can either be a part, which means a single file, and in case it's an HTML file, it would render without its sub-elements. Note that you don't always want to render a HTML file, for instance, if there are malware in it. The other alternative is that it points to a page. For an HTML file, that would be the HTML and all its sub-elements rendering as a web page. For collections, it's recommended only to use parts. If you use page, it will be up to the web archive to find the sub-elements. And it's well known that a web page, even in a web archive, can change over time because of temporalities and enriched data in the web archive. So if we use PIDs with precision parts, we have a good alternative here. To make the actually PID collection PID list, we use the recommendation from the RESOR 2017 paper Data Management of Web Archive Research Data. This consists of the identifier for the collection, a timestamp for when the collection was actually archived, and the contents, where each part of the contents is a persistent web identifier. All other metadata has to be registered elsewhere, pointing to this definition. And each part of the definition has a standard name. The final result is in XML with the collection identifier, the time of making the XML, and all the generated PIDs. If we look at how the PIDs were generated, this was based on the extraction program result. To start with, we thought we had a number of challenges. As mentioned earlier, we thought we had a timestamp challenge, but luckily the walk timestamp was there. To start with, we thought we had a challenge with deduplication. Then it showed out that the researchers only had text from the HTML, and therefore we didn't need to care about the deduplication. However, it also showed out that what was delivered to the researchers was actually with deduplication, so we have an extra task there to do.
What we learned here is that if we made the prints from the very start, we wouldn't have had these headaches.
If we ignore the challenge with deduplication for the delivered data and focus on the widths for the statistical data, we actually end up with a very simple program for generation of the widths.
The archive part was a constant netarkivet.dk. The archival time was a solar Unix time from the program result formatted into standard date format. The precision was part, and the archived URL was also taken from the program result, which completes generation of each of the widths. If we look at some statistics, there were 24 terabytes of data that was delivered to the researchers. The metadata generated by the selection program was about 2 terabytes. The generated width collection was only a little more than half a terabyte.
This consisted of almost 4 billion widths.
And the actual generation of the width lists took 7 hours and a quarter. The generation of the widths was made on the National Dyke Cultural Heritage Cluster at the Royal Danish Library. The reason that it only took about 7 hours was that this is quite a powerful cluster. Besides collection of widths for each of the years, there was also made a collection that covers all the years. This is done by making a collection specification the same way, but with an individual ID and timestamp for creation, but where each of the parts of the collections points to each of the collections for each year. The preservation of the put list is of course not just done by generating the lists. We need to ensure long-term preservation of the results. And the results will only make sense as long as the Netarkivet exists. And of course, as long as we preserve the put collections. But where should the put collections actually be preserved? Should it be part of the National Web Archive? Is it at the institution of the researchers? Or a third preservation organization? There are different political and legal issues to this question. For the time being, the results are queued up to be preserved as part of Netarkivet until final decisions are made. The status is that the PUT has been proposed as a UN and there's been work since 2017. At this stage, 2 of 4 experts have approved. PUIDersNuren is designed for both collections, but also for single references. Since PUID use archive domains to identify web archives, and we don't have any persistent reference to web archives, we are also looking into the possibility of establishing a web archive registry. This could, for instance, be a subject for IIPC.
Concerning PUID support,
there has been made a prototype that can resolve single PUIDs from any archive. This could be matured, maybe with involvement from IIPC and Open Preservation Foundation. There's already support for PUIDs in Solar Wayback. If you search a resource in Solar Wayback, there's an option to ask for the PUIDs for the resource, where the top one is the searched one. If you want to resolve a PUID, Solar Wayback has a service for that. Appending the PUID to the service URL It resolves to what the PWID is pointing at. Additional things that could be included in further work could be to see if Memento could deliver PWID collections for search results, since such search results can vary according to which archive is online or included at the time of searching. Furthermore, we're working on making a policy for making PWIDs upfront in research collections with web archive collections. Thank you for your attention. You can learn more about the PWID via the interactive poster at IDKBDK if you want to.